Week 12 in the NFL.
And there is Josh Allen, the quarterback of the Bills. He has the 7-3 Bills at home as they host the 3-7 Broncos. They are 6-1 versus teams under 500.
There's Derek Carr, 9 TDs, 0 interceptions versus the Jets in his career. Second highest completion percentage in the NFL. After today's win, this Carr will have a victory lap.
Christian McCaffrey leads the NFL in rushing and in total yards and tied for the league lead with 14 touchdowns, 11 rushing and 3 receiving.
There's Drew Brees completing 75% of his passes. That's incredibly has two great weapons, Michael Thomas at wide receiver and Alvin Kamara at running back.
Hello, everyone. I'm James Brown, and welcome to the NFL Today, presented by Jeep. And folks, as we head towards the home stretch of the season, these are the Week 12 headlines here on CBS. With Michael Thomas on a record-setting pace and Drew Brees back in the lineup, the Saints O has looked unstoppable. Today, they'll try to keep things rolling against the Panthers in the Big Easy. Josh Allen has the Bills in the thick of the AFC playoff chase. They'll try to solidify their spot in the standings as they welcome Von Miller and the Broncos into Buffalo. Now, one team looking to overtake the Bills, the Oakland Raiders, and with Derek Carr and Josh Jacobs playing their best football of the season, the Jets are in for a tough showdown today at MetLife. The 6-4 Raiders currently hold the last wild card spot in the AFC playoff. And while the Bills hold the other spot, the Patriots and Ravens are the top two seeds, with the Texans and the Chiefs atop their respective divisions. Meanwhile, over in the NFC, the Niners are the number one seed with the Packers just behind. But that could change tonight as these two square off in a big showdown for the top spot. The Saints and the Cowboys lead their divisions. The Seahawks and Vikings hold the wild cards. Folks, back here inside of Studio 43. Hey, what was the move that we learned this morning? Is that the move there?
Oh, yeah, that's the move.
That's the move right there. Absolutely. Hey, folks, I'm joined at the desk by some brilliant football minds. Yeah. Do we include Phil Simms in that
list? You might as well.
Phil Simms, Coach Bill Cowher, Nate Burleson, and Boomer Esiason. Hey, Drew Brees and the Saints face the Panthers here on CBS. And since his return from injury, Brees has brought his usual steady hand back to the Saints.
JB, take a look at some of these numbers as Drew likes to do this before the game and all this other stuff. It's not the Dak stuff, but his numbers are off the charts. He's completing 76% of his passes, almost 300 yards per game, only one interception. The thing I love about the Saints, they can throw it, they can run it, but more importantly, they don't turn the football over. And when you have one of the best rush defenses in football, that means you are one of the best teams in football. And that's why they were my preseason Super Bowl pick.
That's right. You're going to keep reminding us about that. And yes. Speaking of throwing the ball, who is he throwing it to? It's Michael Thomas. And we're familiar with the numbers, the hands, his ability to go up and snatch the ball, but it's his size and his speed. He's sitting at about 6'3", a little over 200 pounds. He can condense his size, play outside, inside. He can really do it all. And I have an eye vision a little later on in the show.
Oh, yes.
Break down why Michael Thomas is one of the best.
You know what eye vision means,
and
boys.
What does that mean?
No, not when I do it. Oh, well. I don't give him the kiss of death like y'all do.
But you know, offense will definitely get you to the playoffs. Championships, boom, and you mentioned it, is what wins championships. And I'll tell you what, defenses win championships. Cameron Jordan on this defense has been the guy that, to me, has been a stalwart. They're number three against the rush. He's got 9.5 sacks this year. They can get over after the quarterback. So Christian McCaffrey could be in for a long afternoon, which means it puts the pressure on Kyle Allen of the Carolina Panthers. Ooh, wow. And Kyle Allen, you think about him, started off this season great. His first four games, look at these numbers. Here's 4-0. And 7 touchdowns, no interceptions. But the last four games, he's 1-3, 3 touchdowns, 9 interceptions. A lot may be put on him today, Phil. And my question to you is this the future of the Carolina Panthers and Kyle Allen?
Well, listen, he's done a good job this year. No, he's not the future, you know, Bill. And what you look at, I know he's a second-year player, but really, he's a rookie. And what happens to rookies is they play a lot. They mentally, physically, and emotionally, they get worn down. It affects their play. And think what he's going against today. In New Orleans, that crowd noise, a blitzing defense that comes after you, very clever, and his offensive line has struggled protecting him. You said the magic word, Cam Jordan. Nobody talks about him enough. He is a star down in New Orleans that needs more recognition.
And speaking of noise in New Orleans, if you will, let's get our guy in who will be calling the game today. That will be a big hello to Tony Romo. Tony, Saints wideout Michael Thomas, a phenomenal season so far. What makes him so special from your perspective?
Well, there's a multitude of things. Number one, you really can't press him because he has great instincts and he uses his hands and leverage really is about as well as anybody in the NFL. But also, he's strong, he's powerful. So you don't get up and press him because you don't want him. He's just going to throw you out of the way and get open right away. Then he gets a free release, he runs up on you, and he has a great route runner at the top. And that ability with that size, it's really difficult. You don't have a good matchup. That's why you have to double team this guy, and that opened up the whole field for Kamara and everybody else on offense.
All right, Tony, we've got to get you on record now with the playoff races heating up. Who is your favorite to win the NFC?
Well, this never goes well for me, but I think I'm going to go with the 49ers. I really think this team is built the way right now. I don't think you can go into San Francisco and win. Now, they have a tough schedule coming in, so we'll see if they're able to close it out and get the number one seed. But if they do, and that defensive line is healthy, I would not want to go in there and play against that football team.
All right, we know they've got a tough road coming up as well, too. Hey, Tony, as always, thank you so much. Looking forward to your call of the game. All right, folks, for more news and notes from around the league, we send it over to our Hall of Fame colleague. That will be Jim Rome, who's with our NFL Today insider, Jason Lockenford. Jim?
JB, thank you so much. So, Jason, why don't we start with Myles Garrett? He appealed his indefinite suspension earlier this week, but it's been upheld. What does that mean to him and his future?
Spoke to several people at the league office who said technically it's indefinite, but there's every expectation he's reinstated quickly and plays in 2020. As long as he checks in with the NFLPA, schedules a meeting with them, does the same with the league, then he'll be back as long as he's contrite about it. $50,000 fine for Mason Rudolph for his actions. 33 fines, nearly $750,000 from that game, Jim.
I know you've been tracking the Phillip Rivers situation as well. 7 INTs in his last two games, 14 for the season. They're 4-7 overall, and he's in the final year of his contract. What does his future with the Chargers look like?
Multiple people in that organization said they expect the parting of the ways in 2020. You mentioned the age, the contract. They've had no contract talks. None are expected. And, Jim, you live in that area. They're marketing to Inglewood now, fighting the Rams for that market. Phillip lives in San Diego, hasn't really embraced the move. That's grated on some people in the organization.
That's true. And then you've got Panthers owner David Tepper. And, Jason, what he's been saying is he's in a bad mood every time that team loses. He is not going to tolerate mediocrity. What's it mean to the front office, the coaching staff, and the team itself?
He's been in a bad mood a lot lately. At this time last year, he was as well. He talked to people around the league, decided, I'm going to stay put as a rookie owner. If they don't get it right soon, he's not committing to Cam Newton or Ron Rivera's future in the organization. That's internally or externally. I think change is in the air.
Good intel as always, GLC. Thanks so much. Boomer, back to you.
Thanks, Jim and Jason. There's Josh Jacobs, one of the foundational players for the Raiders. Over 400 yards per carry in his last 9 games. That's the longest streak for a rookie running back during the Super Bowl era.
Coming up on the NFL Today, with a number of contenders at the top of the NFC, it will be a fight to the finish. Find out who the guys think is the best shot at lifting up the Lombardi Trophy in Miami. John Gruden and the Raiders have been on a roll, and with a playoff spot within reach, they seem to be on a mission in their final season in Oakland.
Let me hear it from the black hole.
Can't be NFL superstars on the field. There's another way to get in on the fun. And this week, we'll look back at the phenomenon of fantasy football as part of our NFL 100. All that and more when the NFL Today continues here on CBS. The NFL Today is presented by Chrysler. Get a great deal at the Jeep Black Friday event.
Time now for Golden Moments brought to you by McDonald's.
Number one, I love football. I love the players that play it. And I love the city of Oakland.
Let's all start dancing.
And I love the Raiders.
The Oakland Raiders and John Gruden come up with a big win. Raiders in the race for the playoffs.
Every win, I'm going down there. Awesome.
All right, folks, the Red Hot Raiders travel cross country to take on the Jets at the top of the hour right here on CBS. It's the defense that's been golden lately for John Gruden.
JB, Mike Mayock and John Gruden have rebuilt this team. 2,618 snaps for rookies this year thus far. Take a look at this defense. Only 13 sacks all of last year. They have 25 sacks this year. They're led by Trayvon McMullen, Cleveland Farrell, and, of course, John Gruden loves him some Max Crosby. He had 4 sacks last week against the Bengals.
I love when you talk defense, Bill. Yeah. It's great. So you know what? You talk about John Gruden. He has had Derek Carr having one of his statistically one of his better years. 70% completion percentage. Only has thrown 5 touchdowns, 5 interceptions. Leans on Josh Jacobs a lot. But Sam Darnold, the last 2 weeks, has got 5 passing touchdowns and 1 rushing touchdown. They're 2-0. Can they make it 3 in a row today? It'll be interesting to see in the rain out here in MetLife. Talking about a game up in Buffalo Orchard Park, the Broncos come visiting.
All right, listen, I love it when Boomer doesn't talk, but this is going to be a good game today, Denver and Buffalo. Here's Brandon Allen, a quarterback for the Denver Broncos. He's done a good job, got some rhythm in the offense, play action passes, moves around, is mobile, gets some pickups on third down, has really helped this Broncos offense. And then on the Bills, we have Josh Allen. The last 5 games, no interceptions he has thrown. He's been good. He's always mobile, runs around, and really dynamic throwing the football down the field. Tremaine Edmonds, the last guy, linebacker, great tackler, long arms, makes the ball good in pass coverage. This is going to be a close, exciting game.
That's right, AFC North matchup, Pittsburgh Steelers in Cincinnati. Now, Mason Rudolph has struggled on the road like a bad driver, 0-2, 5 interceptions. And listen, no Juju Smith-Schuster, no James Conner. It's going to be tough, but he's going to have to get that offense going. But Minkah Fitzpatrick on the defense side of the ball, he's an absolute beast. He's been helping out that defense. But Ryan Finley, the quarterback, the offense has struggled for Cincinnati. Offense averaging around 11 points per game. He's going to have to pick it up. But super producer Drew Kalisky actually said this morning Cincinnati's going to get their first win. So we shall see. Later on, though, some of y'all will see the Jags versus the Titans in the matchup at 4 Eastern right here on CBS. Hey, Jim, do you believe in the Tennessee Titans?
Hey, Nate, you know I do. Not that long ago, Tennessee was 2-4. Most had written them off completely, but a month later, they've got a new quarterback and they've got a new lease on life. Most had written Ryan Tannehill off. Now he is back with a vengeance and among the best the league has seen since he got that shot. Yeah, I said it. Go ahead, look it up. It's a perfect fit between a brand new Tannehill and the same old Derrick Henry. He's a Mack truck with a Ferrari engine, and he is going to gash the Jags, who allowed not one, but 2 100-yard rushers last week, meaning big dude could go for 2 bills on them today. The Titans are coming off a huge win, a bye, and they are very much alive in the playoff hunt. The Jags are coming off a demoralizing loss, and they're desperate to keep their season alive. So, plenty of juice in this one, JB. And yes, I do love the Titans in this spot.
All right, that is an affirmative, AJ. Meanwhile, the Panthers are going to have their hands full trying to stop Breeze this afternoon. The Saints, all-pro quarterback. Hey, folks, he leads the league in completion percentage. Michael Thomas is another Saints player the Panthers are going to have to keep close tabs on today. Folks, he is on a record-setting pace for receptions this season and has been virtually unstoppable.
Well, there's a reason why Michael Thomas leads the league in receptions.
Wide open, Michael Thomas breaking tackles. Big time game.
And this guy is a handful.
Nice catch. Look at him spin around the defender.
He's one-on-one.
You don't even look at anybody else.
That ball's caught. Mike Thomas.
What a grab.
Boom, across the goal line. Mike Thomas.
No one seems to be able to cover it.
Walks into the end zone. Mike Thomas, touchdown.
Thomas for the touchdown.
You got to throw it to him every time.
Touchdown, Mike Thomas.
And you talk about Michael Thomas, and he's on this record-breaking pace. What does he look like he has right here through 10 games? 94 receptions, and now you're looking at what he's on pace to break. That's Marvin Harrison, 143 he had back in 2002. I remember going against Marvin Harrison and Peyton Manning. Mm. They were dynamic. And you talk about this guy, Michael Thomas, he is a diva, and no one can break him down any better than our resident diva right there. Looking good there, Nate.
That's what I'm talking
break
about, baby.
Michael Thomas.
I appreciate that. He has more catches through 10 games than 2 wide receiver groups in the NFL. But how about this, though? It's the awareness, the physicality, and then knowing how to go get the ball. The safety on the other side of the field, Teddy Bridgewater knows exactly where he's going. Check out how he uses his hand like a baby eating food. 5 yards of separation, and then the yards after catch. He knows exactly where the marker is, so he's going to go get that first down. Inside stem to run a deep out. Check out where the marker is. He doesn't get much separation, but it doesn't matter. You go ahead and high point that ball. We call this the 50-50 ball. Where Mike Thomas is more like 90-10. And here it is right right here. He doesn't get separation. DB's on top. Back shoulder fade ball. Drew Brees, a little toe drag swag. I want you to pay attention to the feet, though. He's going to get those toes down, and then he tracks the ball with his hands, turns around, and hits the ground. A little toe drag swag by Mike Thomas.
He had three shots of that same catch. But you know what? What's great about him, when you think about this, Nate? His body control that he has.
Yeah.
The radius, as you talk about, and his ability to have awareness of where he is on the field.
Yeah.
He's almost unstoppable in this offense that Sean Payton has put together.
That's right. He's a big guy, but he's versatile. You can move him all around.
Totally.
And speaking of big guys that are versatile, over to you, JB.
Throughout the NFL's 100 years, fans have come to enjoy the game of football in many different ways, from radio to television, and even more so through fantasy football. Just about everyone watching football knows today about fantasy football, but few know how it all began until now in the first installment of CBS Sports Presents Celebrating NFL 100 Fantasy Man.
My name is Wilfred Winkenbach, and I'm here to tell you a story. Owning a football team sounds glamorous, right? Private planes, VIP treatment, nothing but respect. Well, not so fast.
Excuse me, have you guys seen a driver for Winkenbach?
Yo, Winkenbach?
Yeah.
From the Raiders, right?
Yes, that's me.
You're late.
I realize that.
You're late. Your driver, Vinny, he left without you, okay?
I hired a car service.
We don't know what to tell you, buddy, all right?
Isn't Oakland in the AFL? Almost Football League? There's a cab line out front. This team sucks.
Hey, buddy, you better get an umbrella. You're gonna need it.
The game is supposed to be fun, right? I mean, call me naive, but that's why I got into it. I figured you build a roster and watch them succeed. That seems easy enough. Well, for me, life was anything but easy.
Hotel Manhattan, please.
To make things worse, that fall we were in the thick of the Cuban Missile Crisis.
You believe these crazy Soviets?
Things just didn't seem all that fun anymore.
I thought the Cubans were on our side. I mean, that Ricky Ricardo seems like a nice fella.
The world was changing fast, and I guess I was just looking for something new to take my mind off things. There's so much in this world you can't control.
Of the Soviet military buildup.
Sure would be nice if you could just create something perfect. Like a team full of stars. And then, suddenly, it was like a light had been turned on. Call it an epiphany or an idea born out of desperation. I had to tell someone. So I called up a couple of guys who knew exactly what I was feeling.
Hey, Scotty, can you grab Bill Tunnel and meet me in the hotel bar in about 15? I want to run something by you guys.
Great. And just like that, I knew how football could be fun again.
We are asking tonight.
So, that night in Hotel Manhattan, as all of America held its breath, we ordered a couple of cocktails and hashed out a plot all our own.
I tell you, this season's gonna be the death of me.
I mean, football is supposed to be fun. We're just miserable. I wanna start my own league.
Wink, there's already two leagues.
Yeah, but this league is different. Okay, think about how much more enjoyable it would be if we had a team full of star players, like the Yankees.
No kidding. Wink, I can't even afford to pay for the bar tab. You want me to buy a professional football team?
I'm talking about a game where we fill our rosters full of players from all of football, AFL and NFL.
Oh, like a pretend league?
Yeah, but the players are real. And so are our rosters. If your players do poorly, you're probably going to lose.
Right. If they do well,
you win.
I kind of forgot how that feels.
Exactly.
I think we're going to need some more drinks.
We couldn't know it then. But what we scratched out on a couple of cocktail napkins that night was the start of something huge.
I got it.
What on earth is going on?
I invited a couple of writers and season ticket holders. I told you about this.
Oh, that pretend game.
It's not pretend.
Well, I just don't understand what it is.
I just think of it as a game within the game.
Game within the game.
Hey, guys, come on.
It's still make-believe, Wayne.
Some people never got it. What can I say?
This is going to be fine.
For these guys, this was the thing we'd all been waiting for. Gentlemen, welcome to the Greater Oakland Professional Pigskin Prognosticators League. Or you could just call it GOPL.
Before we get started, any questions? Bob.
Okay, so the real games are on Sunday. When do we find out the winners of our games?
Faster than you think. My secretary now has a new job. On Mondays, it's just going to be about getting the numbers, and by Tuesday, we'll know who won.
Way to go, Betty.
Scotty, how do we get our lineups to you?
You call Bill by midnight every Friday and tell him your starting roster.
What? When did that become my job?
Just now. Games are head-to-head, and at the end of the season, we will crown a champion.
So what are we actually playing for?
Good question, yeah.
Pride.
What? Pride?
Okay, wow. Hey guys, enough talking, enough talking. All right, let's get started. Andy, you're up. First pick.
Let's go, Andy.
I guess I'll take Blanda.
Wait, we can take players from the NFL too, right?
Yeah, both leagues. All right, you're up next.
Yeah. Well, unless he retired, I'm going to go with Jim Brown.
That's a pick. Okay, Brown.
The
Bill's using his noggin.
Thanks, Andy.
So that's how it happened. With a couple of legal pads and a chalkboard in my rumpus room in Oakland. We just went with our gut, for better or worse. After all, this game is supposed to be fun, right?
Sweet dream, baby.
Maybe I should have taken Jim Brown.
Sweet dream, baby. Sweet dream, baby. How long must I dream, baby?
Oh, great job by Pete Radovich capturing the history of fantasy football and where it started back in 1962 with Wink, the Raiders official. By the way, that Idlewild Airport is now known as JFK here in New York. It's raining here today in New York. We have the Raiders and the Jets today here in New York. So all of this stuff is coming full circle from invention to fascination.
Yeah.
Fantasy football has become an amazing industry.
Yeah. Well, it's been great. Fantasy football has been great for the fans. It's great for the sport of football. No doubt about it. Everybody plays. My sisters, they call me, hey, who should I play this weekend? I don't give them the answers because I don't know. I'm bad at it too. But aren't you glad it wasn't around we played? Oh, my gosh.
It was.
Just one more thing. Back when we were playing, we didn't hear about fantasy football.
I heard about it.
Just but one then more again, thing you know, complain about us as quarterbacks.
But you give us answers on this show.
Because I have the answers. That's why I give them. I don't know what the question was, but.
Hey, folks, we'll keep the conversation going right here. But with kickoff just about a half hour away, and with Pepsi always celebrating at your game, we take you out first on the field with the latest news and updates on your matchup. And later, Nick Foles, Leonard Fournette, and the Jags roll into the Music City to square off against Derrick Henry, Ryan Tannehill, and the Titans for Eastern right here on CBS. But you know what? Since being inserted into the starting lineup, Tannehill has given the Titans playoff hopes a definite boost.
Yeah, he sure has, JB. Since he's been inserted into the lineup, he is 3-1, which is great for the football team. They're scoring more than 10 points a game, higher than they did before he came in, and 72 yards more in total offense. When we're watching play, what you see, he's accurate, he has a sneaky strong arm, and I tell you what I really like about him, he looks like he's finally having fun. He never did in Miami, but his personality is coming through when you watch him play for the Tennessee Titans.
You know, and since he's come over, they were 3-1, as you just talked about. They had their bye week. And for Mike Vrabel, what better scenario can you have when you talk about the fact that you can control your own destiny? You look at their schedule from here on out. They play Jacksonville today, Indianapolis next week, and Houston in two of the last 3 weeks. Derrick Henry looked at for him to have a big day today, but we're against a Jacksonville defense that really struggles against the run.
I will say this about the Jaguars, and this is not about Nick Foles. It's about Leonard Fournette. He only touched the ball 8 times last week against the Colts. He was angry, and he made a lot of people hear his anger. So I would suspect today we are going to see him touch the ball quite a bit. And by the way, Ryan Tannehill, he's a free agent at the end of the season. Best time of your career to be playing some of the best football that you've been playing.
Oh, so they're going to feed Fournette.
Oh,
right?
Definitely.
You're right about that. Well, listen, when it comes to Nick Foles, one of his favorite targets will be DJ Chark. And he went from unfamiliarity last year to being a household name. And right now, that young man is balling out. He had 14 catches last year, 0 TDs. Now he's tied for the league lead in catches. He leads in every major statistical category. He's battling a hammy this week, but I expect him to go out there and make some plays for Nick Foles. But here's Luke Kuechly. He's a beast. 90 tackles, 2 interceptions this year. He's playing in New Orleans and wants to treat it like Mardi Gras. He's going to have a party in the backfield.
During the NFL Salute to Service campaign, USAA encourages all players to salute our nation's military and veterans by displaying a decal on their helmet representing a branch of the military or a specific veteran. Panthers running back Christian McCaffrey honors those that have been awarded a Purple Heart.
Spencer Milroe is somebody who I met a while ago. He's somebody that, you know, I look up to in every facet of my life. And getting to know him has been a lot of fun, just to hear his stories and to understand what he's gone through. I think it's incredibly important to everybody who plays football and the whole Salute to Service Month and what it means to us, just understanding that we play a game for a living. Without them, you know, I'm not allowed to do what I love. So I'm very fortunate that we do take a month out to honor them.
McCaffrey will be wearing a military decal on his helmet today to show his appreciation for our military. Meanwhile, on the field, he is putting together another incredible season. And as the NFL celebrates its 100th season with the unveiling of its all-time team, perhaps one day he'll be among the greats like Emmitt Smith.
I've never seen anybody take so many 2-yard gains and turn them into 8-yard plays. I've never seen anything like it.
Bill, coming from you, that is monumental, because I consider you to be one of the best coaches, if not the best coach in all of football.
I don't know how you can say that, because you killed us every time. You only ran for 120 yards every time we played you. I'm truly enamored by the way that you can set up blocks and run the football on such a consistent basis. You're the one that I just marvel at the way you make the blocks for the linemen. Even if they're not good blocks, you make them good blocks. And then find the space and get through it. And then, you know, you have such good pad level through the line of scrimmage that you're hard to tackle once you get your pads down.
I'm not 6 feet.
I know.
I'm only 5'9½, and when I'm running, I'm about 5'6". So I shrink.
Yeah, but he was 6 feet tall in terms of heart. And you know what? There aren't many who did it better than the Hall of Famer Emmitt Smith. Next week, the NFL reveals that is its all-time team, defensive line and linebackers. And folks, we're looking forward to watching these two in their matchup today. Christian McCaffrey and Alvin Kamara. Does it get any better than that? They're currently among the best running backs in the game. As we go inside the pregame HQ, delivered by Domino's. You should have known in the first place.
A block at the line, bangs over the goal line, touchdown, Cowboys.
Cousins rolls left, throws end zone, touchdown!
Russell Wilson steps up, takes it to the house.
More Russell Wilson magic.
Breeze looks to throw, front corner of the end zone, touchdown! Mike Thomas!
Gonna go to the end zone.
What a catch it is by Aaron Jones.
Rodgers with the touchdown.
And Dak Prescott bet on himself, and now he is playing some of the best ball of his career. In fact, it is one of the best seasons ever by a QB wearing the star, and he has worked his way into the MVP debate. But He still needs a statement win, and now he has his chance. Go on the road, beat Tom Brady and the Patriots in their house, and that's as big as a statement gets. But let's not get it twisted. It's not Dak v. Tom. It's Dak v. Stephon, and that's secondary. And it's Dak v. Belichick. And even worse for Dak, it is the clapper versus the hoodie, because while Dallas is more talented, 1 through 53, the dude from Princeton is the weak link. Dak needs a statement win and a better coach. Unfortunately, if he gets the first, he may never get the second. Now, the Packers are good, maybe even Super Bowl good. The Niners are good, maybe even Super Bowl good as well. Unfortunately, they are banged up. So banged up that Kyle Shanahan actually said he was hoping the 4 extra hours they get for the late start could help his guys who are dinged. Now, I'd say the same if I were him, but it's hard to see it. Then again, if anybody can impact a game at less than full strength, it's George Kittle. But it says here, not having a full healthy arsenal is only going to put more pressure on Jimmy Garoppolo. Meanwhile, I did speak to Aaron Rodgers on Friday. Trust me, he knows exactly what he's up against with that nasty Niner D. This one's going to come down to which quarterback hits the big plays. And Jimmy G is not outslinging A-Rod, not without his best targets at 100%, and not against a well-rested Packers team that has played its best football against its best opponents, JB.
Ooh, J.R. Thank you so very much. All right, folks, as you can see, Thanksgiving is just around the corner. My guys, I think we're still friends here. Is that right, Phil?
We're good, are we all friends?
Well, we act like we are.
Oh, we fake it. Okay, good. So we're going to celebrate Friendsgiving on the NFL today. This is, I guess you could call this potluck. Right. So let's set the table. The race for the top spot in the NFC is wide open. Who are you going to bring to our feast to represent the NFC in the Super Bowl?
Well, JB, who else but the... Why do you have two plates? I don't like that.
He's greedy.
He's the coach. The New Orleans Saints, thank you very much. I've been on them since week one, and what can I say? Really? They won 5 games with Teddy Bridgewater as their starting quarterback, 5-0. We saw the numbers about Drew Brees, what he has been doing since he's been back. You know Kamara. You also know Thomas. You also know Drew Brees. Do you know Cam Jordan? Do you know that defense? You're just slobbering all over him up there in the pregame show. So I'm telling you right now, this is the team that deserves to go to this year's Super Bowl because they got jobbed last year in the NFC Championship game.
All right, I'll jump right in, guys. I brought a San Francisco treat, and I'm not talking about minute rice, okay? Now listen, the San Francisco 49ers, they got one hell of a schedule coming up. They got the Packers, Ravens, Saints, and they finish off with the Falcons, who found their groove, and the NFC West rivals the Rams and the Seahawks. But here's the thing. They got the number two scoring offense, number two scoring defense, the only team left top five in both. And they've been doing this while being banged up in very key spots. Now imagine when they get 100% healthy right in time for the playoffs, the San Francisco 49ers might be the most built team to make a run to Miami.
That was delicious. But if there's one team that has one player that you'd want to have the ball in his hands, go to a Super Bowl, who would that be? How about Russell Wilson? Your MVP pick a few weeks ago. Russell Wilson is having another career year. Russell Wilson has Chris Carson. He's got Ty Lockett. And you know what they picked up? Jadeveon Clowney. And you saw how he can wreck offenses. Mm-hmm. We saw that. But you know what? I was so torn. And we have all these people up here who love to eat. With what we're talking about, the two quarterbacks and JB.
Love to eat? Why'd you point the field?
So I brought a side dish.
He missed a side dish.
So the side dish right here is going to be the Minnesota Vikings. Yep. How about Kirk Cousins?
Yep. Yep.
21 touchdowns.
Doing it.
3 interceptions, 70% completion percentage. Dalvin Cook, I'm telling you, defense number 5th against points. There they are, the Vikings and the Seahawks.
Okay, as usual, y'all vein up all the time. There's not much time left for me, which I'm sure you're happy about, Boomer.
Yes.
But, you know, here's what I got. Since it's like being in my house with all my brothers and sisters. The plate came to me. It was empty, but I like the Cowboys. I got to take them. Tell me a position that they're not good at. That's the question. Name one.
Jim Rome just said it.
What did he say?
He said the head coach.
Well, I'm talking about on the field. They are loaded everywhere. 3 franchise offensive linemen, a quarterback, a running back, the defense, 2 great pass edge rushers. JB, I know you got a team you want to show.
Normally, I leave that to you guys, but which quarterback would you like to have the ball in the hands of if it's down to the crunch?
Drew Brees.
Well, give me, who's it to?
Russell Wilson.
Can anybody argue with this guy? Aaron Rodgers, you know what his touchdown to interception ratio
is
for the past 2 years? 42 touchdowns,
four picks.
Well, answer me this. That's how's their run defense?
Hey, look here. No, I'm look here. They're still getting it done. Their run defense helped them in the early part of the season, right? And they're getting it done now. And also, speaking of running, Aaron Jones tied for the most touchdowns, total touchdowns this year, along with Christian McCaffrey.
Keep it going,
that's 14.
Keep it going.
But Bill would say, those are the analytics. Bill, wait. I like what you said. There's got to be a place for a feel in the game, your head in the game. Aaron Rodgers in the vernacular is a beast. Wow. I want the ball to do.
You're doing it with meanness. That
was absolutely. Great.
You need to go home.
And Phil, you might have got the scraps when you were younger, but you sure enough made up for it. All right, here we go. There's Cole Beasley, Bill's wide receiver. He's become a favorite target of Josh Allen. He knows all about playing in Thanksgiving. And he will again on Thursday up against his former team, the Cowboys, right here on CBS.
The NFL Today is sponsored by GEICO. 15 minutes could save you 15% or more on car insurance. Jersey Mike Subs. Be a sub above. And by Chrysler. Get a great deal at the Jeep Black Friday event.
As part of the Jaguars' salute to service, players visited with sailors at Naval Air Station Jacksonville, where they got to test their flight skills in the aviation simulator and also took a personal tour of the P-8A Poseidon aircraft.
All right, JB, it's Allen Day here on CBS. There's Kyle Allen. He's getting ready to play against the Saints. He beat them last year, Week 17. Sean Payton rested a lot of his players. He's thrown 9 interceptions in his last 4 games.
And there's Brandon Allen. He's been on 3 teams, 3 TDs, 1 interception, but he's completing just under 50% of his balls. He has to step that up.
Josh Allen, last 5 games with his best football. He's got 8 touchdowns thrown, 4 rushing, and 0 interceptions. And they are 7-3.
Well, here's my Josh Allen. He doesn't throw the ball. He tackles the guy that throws it. And look at those numbers when you see what he has done. 8 sacks, 16 quarterback hits. He has definitely lived up to being picked high in the draft 2 years ago.
All right. And as already been said, Allens are all over the field today. Boomer said that. And playing in games right here on the NFL on CBS. So with Allens on our mind, the question is, who is your favorite all-time?
Wait a minute. I'm not going to sit here and say favorite, but I just can't get this guy out of my mind. It's Eric Allen. He was a defensive back for the Philadelphia Eagles back in 1993. We were playing.
Oh, wow. Look at this.
What is it? Well, just hang on.
Wait.
Throw an interception.
Okay, Boom. You're going to make this tackle, right?
Oh, I can't make the tackle. He runs it all the way back for
a interception. You got it. You got it, Boom.
No.
What?
Look at that.
Was that a business decision?
Calm down. It was an illegal block on this play where that touchdown shouldn't have been allowed.
We don't care. We don't care about your effort. That's all we cared about.
I had effort.
You know, but honestly, Broom, what happened on that?
That was awful.
It was return for a touchdown, Coach.
Yes.
Well, he's sensitive about that, Bill.
There was a block in the back on Johnny Mitchell, my tight end. That ball should have been all the way brought back, but it wasn't, but we ended up losing.
Oh, look, Bill, go about what we see.
Well, we got to move on, but Bill, it's clear he's very sensitive about that.
Oh, he's very sensitive.
No question.
Got to make that tackle, though.
It's time for the NFL Today Picks presented by Allstate. A perfect time for some more mayhem. Boomer.
I'm taking the Jets over the Raiders today over the Meadowlands and inclement weather.
All right, I'm going with the Cowboys over the Patriots. I feel like they're going to run the rock, and also Dak Prescott is going to use his arm as well as his legs.
JB sold me on Aaron Rodgers. I'm taking Green Bay over San Francisco.
I'm taking the Rams over the Baltimore Ravens. So there you go.
Wow.
And my favorite Allen, just in case you want to know, was Larry Allen.
Is Boomer cool?
Yeah, he's cool. He's a little sensitive. It's not our fault he didn't make any effort on the tackle.
Kickoff is just a few minutes away, a few moments away. But hey, take a look. Hey, Nate,
look at this.
All right, Boomer, you got it.
Come on,
you're gonna crush it.
Go, Boomer. You got it. Head up, Boom.
Oh,
really?
Man, you didn't need it. You guys are so mean.
The NFL Today is presented by Chrysler. Get a great deal at the Jeep Black Friday event.
Now hear this, a reminder later, Nick Foles, Leonard Fournette, and the Jags rode into the Music City to square off against Derrick Henry, Ryan Tannehill, and the Titans for Eastern right here on CBS as we welcome you back to the NFL Today and game day delivery presented by Amazon. Time now for another round of Phil's favorite game, folks, that would be believe or make believe. And we'll begin with Boomer. Boomer, Ryan Tannehill will be the starting quarterback of the Titans next season, believe wow. or make believe?
You know what? I believe. He's going to be a free agent, and I think because of his success, Mike Vrabel is going to push that front office to sign him next year. I could see maybe a 3 or 4 year deal. I don't see it as a mega deal, but I do think it is. He's playing himself into a very good situation.
You said he's playing his best football. You're talking about going to free agency, and he really is. I mean, they're 3-1, like you talked about. And
yep.
The pressure's off him. The only thing you got to be aware of with him is, like, when he is named a starter, if he goes somewhere,
the pressure's back on.
Is the pressure come back on?
If he stays, that's why I say, if he stays in Tennessee on a 3 or 4 year deal, maybe that makes the most sense.
We all recognize that offense has a different type of flow with Ryan Tannehill running.
Yeah, he's got confidence, got a big arm, you know. And I'll never forget this. Dan Marino takes the job down in Miami. And the first time I ever saw Ryan Tannehill, I happened to be around him, and he goes, you know, he can really throw. Mm-hmm. And it comes out from Dan Marino. That's pretty important stuff. And if it's my favorite game, how come it never starts with me?
Talk to Drew Kalisky. I asked the same question.
Let's go to Boomer.
Hey, Nate's got one of the suits from his suit collection, Burleson collection. Nate, Dak Prescott, is he a top 5 quarterback in the league?
I believe 100%. You know, I look at the quarterback position as the MVP leaders. You know, you got Russell Wilson, Lamar Jackson, and then, you know, it's Aaron Rodgers, Deshaun Watson, Kirk Cousins is playing unbelievable. Dak Prescott is sandwiched right in the middle because he can do it with his arm and then also his legs. And he plays big in big moments. And I expect him to have another big moment today up against the Patriots.
And I think this will be a very much of a kind of a litmus test for him, you know, because these are the games that the Cowboys have to kind of make a statement on, right?
Yeah.
So you look at this offense, and he does have a lot of weapons around him. It's not real creative, Phil, but yet they ask him to do a lot, and he has come through to this point.
He makes it creative because he's big, he can break tackles, and his movement, that's what makes, you know, gives it more creativity. And Dak Prescott, this will be a big test because he's got a great wide receiver group he throws to.
Yeah.
But he's going against the best defense.
I hate to say it. Eventually, they're going to have to pay him. I can't believe they haven't paid him.
The price is going up, boom.
If he wins this game and they go on to win the NFC East.
$40 million a year.
It's going to be
they got to pay Amari Cooper, too, now.
Yeah, well, you can't pay them both. Can't pay everybody.
Hey,
yeah.
What side dish did Bill Cowher bring
the
to
Vikings. Friends? The Vikings. Yeah.
The Vikings, yeah. Bill. Yeah. The Vikings will make it to the NFC Championship game, believe or make believe.
Wait, did you see the dish I brought? The Seattle Seahawks?
Mm-hmm.
Why can that not be the championship game? So I think that they can. I think when you look at the Minnesota Vikings, I understand that they're 1-2 in their division, but the Minnesota Vikings are playing as good a football as anybody right now. Talk about Kirk Cousins. You talk about Cook.
Dalvin Cook.
You talk about Thielen has not really been healthy. He gets healthy. The Diggs. And then you talk about a defense. It's fifth against in scoring defense. So this is a team, Danielle Hunter can rush the quarterback. This is a team that could go on the road. They are playing their best football right now. I say that if they have to go on the road, I would take that running game and that defense. I think they'll be in the championship.
Here's what I like about them is that Mike Zimmer, the coach, is now kind of changed what he's doing on the defensive side. He had a formula, always went with it. Now he changes it week to week, like when he played the Cowboys. He said, Dak, throw for 400, but you're not running Zeke. And it worked.
Nate, it seems like I thought I knew the chords of my guys not to touch. I mean, these guys getting a little salty up here now, right?
Oh, yeah.
Bill's like, did you see what my side dish was or the main dish
constantly
was?
Reminding us what they're talking about. We're on the show. We heard you, Coach.
All of you all, the Bengals, start with you, Coach. The Bengals will finish 0-16 this season. Believe or make believe?
Make believe.
Make believe?
I have to win a game.
Oh, is it my turn? Make believe.
Make believe?
I think they're going to win one.
I believe it. They're struggling right now. I don't see them getting a dub.
Purposely went to Boomer last.
They are they're in the Joe Burrow sweepstakes. They're going to draft a kid from LSU. I don't think they're going to win a game.
Wow.
Negative. He's a negative. The negative guy. That's all I can say.
They'll win the draft. That's what they'll win.
Nate.
Hey, listen, we'll see you back here at 4 Eastern right here on CBS.
And the guys, I promise you, they won't be salty at that point, right?
It's my favorite game. He never asked me a question.
He didn't get a turn. What can I say?
What happened?